There is really very little health advantage in CBD the way is now most commonly used. So there was a 1992 paper that got me involved in cannabinoids, and particularly in what we call today the endocannabinoids. So the compounds that our body and our brains, but also our body, make, which activate the cannabinoid receptors, the same receptors that are activated by the main ingredient, the main psychotropic, we say, intoxicating, this means ingredient in cannabis, which is the famous delta-9 THC, delta-9 tetrahydrocannabinol. Cannabis has served, just for science, a remarkable purpose, because the fact that cannabis allowed us to uncover in the body this signaling mechanism, this signaling complex that is not just present in the brain, like dopamine or serotonin, but is present everywhere in almost every cell of the body and plays important roles in so many different organ systems. That alone is a gift that this plant has given us, which I feel we should be grateful for. But also, the other thing that I think is important for your viewer to appreciate is that every time we talk about cannabis and THC containing cannabis, which is the one that most people use to be high and stoned, we're talking about interaction between cannabis and this signaling system, this endocannabinoid system. Because if we didn't have the system, cannabis wouldn't do anything to us. These are small molecules that have very little information. They will probably just go flow through our body without any impact. But because we have the endocannabinoid system, now all of a sudden they can do all these pretty remarkable things, both positive, and there's also the negative, of course.
What's the evolutionary purpose of this ubiquitous molecule? I knew that it was in the brain, but you're telling us that it's actually in every cell. What would be the evolutionary benefit of this endocannabinoid system?
Evolutionary questions are always very hard to answer. It's easy to come up with just so stories. We think that, blah, blah. But the best way to answer is just to look at the function. And by function, I mean what we know the system is used for. When you look at people who use cannabis, most people use it, who use it recreationally, do so because they want to feel better. They want to be in a better mood. They want to go dance, and they don't want to have any intrusive thoughts in their mind. They want to relax, maybe. They want to watch a movie, listen to some music. So that element itself, this pharmacological piece of information, tells us already what the endocannabinoid system does. And in fact, we have now much more evidence based on a variety of experiments that tell us that mood regulation, and particularly the protection, the maintenance of a positive mood, a mood that allows to cope with stress. The endocannabinoid system at large in the body has an overarching role of getting us to eat more and getting us to absorb more nutrients and getting us to store those nutrients. And one of the places where there is a cannabinoid receptor that is most important in regulating appetite is a little part of the brain called the hypothalamus that is sitting at the base of the brain. And the hypothalamus contains cannabinoid receptors in the right cells, and it's a very complex set of networks, but in the right cells that when those receptors are stimulated, there is an increase in the hunger, in hunger. So it is not just what happens in fat, is what happens in the entire body that make people who use cannabis feeling more hungry and also capable of storing better the nutrients that they eat.
Before I go into the potential harms, what are the benefits of marijuana?
We have to distinguish between those that, say, our states accept and those that actually science, empirical evidence has demonstrated to be objectively correct, those that have the highest level of empirical evidence. And the top one is nausea, because the nausea induced by, say, chemotherapeutic agents, anti-cancer agents, or the older style HIV drugs, that kind of nausea is wonderfully blocked by cannabis. There is even a drug, there are actually two drugs in the market. They are pure THC, synthetic THC, Marinolin syndrome, which are approved for the treatment of nausea. So that conclusive evidence. Then we have evidence that is not conclusive, but it is, say, very strong or substantial. And for that, the first thing that comes to mind is pain. There are many, many studies suggesting that THC and cannabis, not CBD, THC and cannabis, so marijuana proper, are effective in treating chronic pain for adults.
So you've spoken before about an interesting case in which someone with a rare genetic mutation was unable to feel pain.
Absolutely. That's another example of another function of the endocannabinoid system in the brain, not mood regulation, but pain regulation. This particular person, and is one individual so far, that, at least to my knowledge, one person who is missing, almost completely missing, the ability to destroy one of the endocannabinoids, right? This lady was discovered because she went for surgery and they asked her what kind of analgesics she wanted. And she said, I don't need analgesics. And the doctors, you can imagine, they went like this. What do you mean you don't need analgesics? So everyone needs analgesics. So no, I don't need painkillers. I never used painkillers. Even when I had in doing childbirth, I didn't feel the pain. And she's a happy-go-lucky person with always in a good mood. And so people, they ask, so if you don't feel any pain, I said, how come you don't have injuries because you don't feel the pain? And now you don't know you're hurting yourself all the time.
Correct.
And she said, yeah, I do hurt myself. And she showed actually on her arm, she showed that she had just burned herself or something. Said, but for some reason, said, I heal right away.
I usually never interrupt. I apologize, I'm interrupting. This is interesting. Was she really healing faster?
Yes.
I'm incredulous about that, but okay.
Yes, that's what in the paper that describes her her mutation, there are photographs of that. I don't know exactly what kind of wounds they were, but they were perfectly healed. And she, of course, you know, have to rely on her testimony as well. But again, with all the limitations of being one case, et cetera, it was striking because it fits almost perfectly what FA would be blocking, because FA, the enzyme that you mentioned, blocks the degradation of one class of endocannabinoids. And what happens is that you would have lower pain, you would have better mood, you would have higher, quicker wound healing. So it is almost a perfect case study, to the point that it's so perfect that I am a little bit skeptical about it, but it's interesting. There is really very little health advantage in CBD the way is now most commonly used. My suggestion to people who use CBD is just don't. There is no reason to spend money on something that there is no proof that is working. And if it works for you, good for you. But if it doesn't work, just stop it, drop it. It's not going to be, you're not going to lose anything. Anyone who's ever tried cannabis knows that if you try and read something, yeah, you're very focused, you can read. But then by the time you're at the end of the sentence, you forgot what is in the beginning of the sentence. And sometimes when you're speaking under the influence of cannabis, the beginning of the sentence gets blurred by the time you're at the end. Your working memory is affected. There is an endocannabinoid system in these critical regions of the brain that allow us to consolidate memories. One of them is called the hippocampus. Is very important. And it is really a funnel through which initial memories get processed before being sent to the cortex again. There are cannabinoid receptors there. And one thing that has been discovered now for many years is that activation of those receptors blocks the potentiation. And that clearly tells us that we have a neural mechanism for the loss of memory that people experience when they use cannabis. But now I have to be specific. This is under the influence. So when you are under the influence of cannabis, so there's THC in your brain. It does not mean that continuous use or periodic use or regular use, whatever you want to call it, will cause a damage that is persistent. There is persistent damage that could occur, very likely does occur, when we use during adolescence. And this is the kind of stuff I'm most worried about. Not so much the acute effects, the acute intoxication. As long as one is educated enough and smart enough to do it in a safe place and in a safe way, I don't worry too much about that. But I do worry about vulnerable populations, such as teenagers, for example, or persons who are expecting, pregnant people.